Okay, I think we will try to begin. So I would like to welcome everybody here. And for me, it's really a great honor and pleasure to be able to introduce Martha Schwartz. I think, and I hope, that she doesn't need a big introduction. She's, of course, you could say, quite a legendary figure. One of probably the most important female landscape architects of our times, practicing worldwide. And a really important woman in terms of leading the field in education, in practice, in design thinking, and in challenging the norms of the profession. She's done this since the beginning when she started working, and she continues to do it today, which I think we'll begin to see when she gives her talk beyond practice. She's been critically acclaimed and has won a whole series of awards. She has an office. She's just moved back to the United States, and we were discussing and laughing a bit with Dean Ma, because I've also been a person who's moved back to the United States recently, of the difficulty of culture shock, especially in these times, these political times that we're going through now. Martha's moved back from London, having been living in the UK for 11 years, where she had her office, still has the main component of her office, and is relocated to New York City. She also has an office with thriving work in China. She's retained and has been for many, many years, I don't actually know the exact number, but for many years, a professor of practice at Harvard's Graduate School of Design. And she's retained that role for, as I said, many decades. I don't mean that in a bad sense. I mean that in the sense that she's educated many important landscape architects, many of which we're fortunate to have here at USC. As I say, she's won numerous awards. She's been recognized internationally. Very important award to mention, of course, is the Cooper Hewitt Museum National Design Award. She is a fellow of the American Society of Landscape Architects, is recognized also by the RIBA, has had visiting residences at the American Academy in Rome and Radcliffe College. And her projects literally span the globe. In the beginning of her career, she was working in many cities across the United States. And more recently, she's been building quite a lot in the UK, but also in places as remote and in the news, places like Syria, Qatar, the UAE, and also quite a lot in China. And her projects, I think, are really, of course, she's gotten a large reputation as having humor in her projects, pop art. But I was also reading an article, an interview, where she was discussing the humor in her family, her great admiration for many comics, stand-up comedians, and the understanding that the intelligence behind great comedians is that they're discussing very serious things. And many of the critics that take lightly her comical humor in her projects perhaps aren't understanding the very deep questions that she's raising. Many of her works also look at issues like post-mining, and the deep and very serious issues of reclamation. And I think we'll begin to see some of these today. There are important books and monographs that have come out on the office's work. a very important one called Recycling Spaces, Curating Urban Evolution. So I think you begin to understand that for Martha and her office, the urban and the landscape are intimately intertwined. And there's a new monograph that Martha just mentioned to me that has come out in China about Martha Schwartz and Partners. I was lucky enough to be with Martha in Philadelphia during the summer, where there were a series of people invited to make landscape architecture declarations. We are invited by the Landscape Architecture Foundation, which is doing really wonderful work to promote landscape architecture. And Martha's really gave a very forceful call to arms for the profession. She demanded, this was in June, that landscape architects become much more political than they are today, that they take a stand, that they begin to work on Capitol Hill, that the American Society of Landscape Architects starts to address in a very serious way climate change, that it's responsible that all landscape architects, I would even extend that thinking more broadly, that all designers of everybody who's working in the built environment are responsible for planet Earth and are responsible for what is happening, the mass destruction of it. She spoke really passionately, raised a lot of was leading a charge to say that we need to act now before it's too late. What I would like to read to you is a few sentences. I asked Martha if she would mind if I took a few more minutes than usual, just because I fear that some of you might not know about this, and I would like you to become aware. Landscape Architecture Magazine, or known as LAM, had 2 days ago, the 15th of November, Brad McKee, who's the editor of this magazine, put forth an editorial that he called Get Ready. So this was, of course, a few days after Robert Ivey's, I think, quite horrible letter immediately after Trump's election. Brad McKee has written, I think, an incredibly thoughtful piece that you can all look at online. But I would like to read you a few sentences from that, because I think it echoes what Martha asked us to do in June, and I think we'll hear more about now. So it, as I said, is called Get Ready. So the first sentence of this, it says, there can scarcely be any overstating the threat that the Trump presidency poses to the interests of the landscape architecture community, which center ardently on the welfare of human society and ecology of the planet. So a few sentences later, during the campaign, Trump's positions on public policy, such as they were, and fairly obscured by endless evidence of his career as a liar, a swindler, a bully, a bigot, and a sexual predator, did not, to me, warrant detailed study. So then a bit later, no, what got my attention most, and then since, is the Republican Party platform. The section on natural resources begins on page 17, on oil drilling. Quote, we support the opening of public lands and the outer continental shelf to exploration, end quote. On President Obama's clean power plan, quote, we will do away with it altogether, end quote. On coal, quote, the Democratic Party does not understand that coal is an abundant, clean, affordable, reliable domestic energy resource, end quote. On the Keystone XL pipeline, quote, after years of delay, the president killed it to satisfy our environmental extremists. We intend to finish that pipeline and others, end quote. On the US Environmental Protection Agency, quote, we propose to shift responsibility for environmental regulation from the federal bureaucracy to the state and to transform the EPA into an independent bipartisan commission. We'll enforce the original intent of the Clean Water Act. It's not distortion by EPA regulations. We will likewise forbid the EPA to regulate carbon dioxide, something never envisioned when Congress passed the Clean Air Act. End quote. On the 640 million acres of public lands in the federal portfolio, quote, Congress shall immediately pass universal legislation providing for a timely and orderly mechanism requiring the federal government to convey certain federally controlled public lands to states. And on tentative progress made towards reversing climate change, quote, we reject the agendas of both Kyoto Protocol and the Paris Agreement. So there's another paragraph which I won't read, which you should read online. But his last paragraph said, this is the least of it for now. As I write this tonight, a prominent anti-Semite, Stephen Bannon, is being named a White House strategist. We know our obligation. I am proud to be part of ASLA because its vision is this, leading the design and stewardship of land and communities. We know that in fulfilling it, we stand against self-interest and conflicted interests. The job description just got bigger for all of us. So that's how Brad McKee ends. And I think this is how Martha Schwartz began already in June. And I think we'll see how Beyond Practice continues tonight. So I thank Martha very much. She spent also 3 hours of her time today looking at student work, which I think was a great lesson for all of us. And I can just say we're really, really happy to have you here, Martha, and I hope you'll return many more times.
Yeah. Okay. Jesus. I guess I missed that statement from Brad McKee. That's just kind of, I don't know. I just want to go to a bar. Okay. Oh, my God. It makes me feel sick. Okay. Have to kind of pull my act together here. All right. I am going to kind of go back to what I talked about at what Kelly mentioned at the LAF meeting in June, because I've actually found that while almost everybody understands that there's climate change, and climate change is going on, it seems like very, very few people really understand global warming and the rate at which global warming is really happening. They don't really understand the science behind it or aren't really in touch with what the scientific community is saying. And I mean, even my own department, I mean, people in landscape architecture, people who, you know, you would assume would kind of know this stuff. And it's only recently until I started actually, you know, becoming glued to the internet and looking up different scientists and what they're saying and listening to the YouTube that I've started to get completely kind of freaked out and chasing my own tail in terms of kind of what can be done, because it's serious. And this is part of a promise that I made to myself that I would actually do what I could do. And unfortunately, I guess for you guys, that you're part of the promise to myself, which was to kind of use my own really tiny little bully pulpit to actually bully you guys. So anyway, I just wanted to start. And we will get to showing pictures of work, but I want to do this first. But I believe that the scientific consensus on human-induced global warming is now indisputable. James Hansen, who is a leading climate scientist, previously from NASA and respected for many predictions that have proven to be true, recently issued a grim warning that we are nearing the point of no return when it comes to reversing or even mitigating the adverse effects of climate change. Here are a number of alarming facts that provide evidence that global warming is upon us and happening faster than predicted. And these are from from NOAA, which is the National Oceanographic Atmospheric Administration. In November 2015, a 1 degree centigrade planetary rise in temperature was officially acknowledged, but also widely believed to be conservative, as the scientists tend to be conservative, which is the halfway mark to the 2% target or safe limit to avoid catastrophic global warming. 2015 was the warmest year on record, and this past decade is the warmest since 1880. Here are three diagrams of projected warming through 2039, which show extremely hot seasons per decade. So the present one, all the way to your left, shows a range of 0 to 3 extremely hot seasons in 10 years, with the hottest areas primarily in the Southwest and Upper Midwest, as they are now, kind of now, to 2019. The second one shows the heated areas in the Southwest expanding north and west with an increase, with an increase from 4 to 7 extremely hot seasons. And the East Coast is just starting to warm up with 2 to 3 hot seasons in a 10-year span. And the third, all the way to your right, which takes us to 2040, shows the extreme heating of the Southwest expanding to the West Coast, basically covering a good third of the United States, and the East Coast and most of the US also heating up, but not quite as drastically. Okay, sea level rise rose 6.7 inches in the 20th century, and at the rate that we're going now, the last decade, it's nearly doubled that of the last century. This is New York. I'm trying to find a place in New York, and I have this map, and I'm definitely avoiding any of those places that are blue. Here you can see, this is about the oceans heating up, and that orange spot is the land heating up, the land and atmosphere. But more than 90% of the warming has happened on Earth over the past 50 years in the oceans, because it absorbs most of the heat. The heat already stored in the ocean will eventually be released, committing Earth to additional warming in the future. So, I mean, basically, the deal is even if we were to go to zero carbon like today around the world, we would have a couple hundred years of more continued heating in the atmosphere, but thousands of years before the oceans would actually cool back down. Ocean acidification has increased by 30% since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, and this change represents approximately a 30% increase in acidity. So this graph shows the acidity going up, you know, from 1995, 2005, it's just going up like logarithmically. The green is the carbon dioxide that's being absorbed, which then combined with oxygen turns into acid. And the future predictions indicate that the oceans will continue to absorb carbon dioxide and become even more acidic. Estimates of future carbon dioxide levels based on business as usual emission scenarios indicate that by the end of this century, the surface waters of the ocean could be nearly 150% more acidic, resulting in a pH that the oceans haven't experienced for more than 20 million years. Now, this, of course, is contributing to the bleaching of the coral reefs, but it also threatens sea life, which in the end threatens life on land. The ice sheets in Greenland and the Antarctic are shrinking more rapidly than predicted. The Arctic shows near record minimums of sea ice since 2002. And the recent years represent a unique event because there is a year-to-year persistence of minimum ice. Sea ice area is now significantly below the level of the 1980s and earlier. And the Arctic, if you're not aware of this, is heating up more rapidly than any other part of the globe. Now, that red circle there is the Eastern Siberian Arctic Shelf. And here, methane is being released, which is one of the most urgent threats of all. We have now exceeded the projected tipping point of 350 parts per million of carbon dioxide, and we're now at 400 parts per million, which is heating up our land and air, ice, and oceans, with the equivalence of 400,000 Hiroshima atomic bombs a day. The heated Arctic Ocean is causing the permafrost of the Eastern Siberian Arctic Shelf to melt, releasing methane, which is a gas that's 20 to 30 times more potent than carbon dioxide as a heat-trapping gas, into the atmosphere. There are such massive reserves of methane in the subsea Arctic that if only a small percentage is released, it can lead to a jump in the average temperature of the Earth's atmosphere by 10% degrees centigrade. Now, recent observations in the Siberian Arctic show increased rates of methane escaping from the seabed now. And the methane is both in the water and in the air above the sea. And these facts have produced a very plausible scientific prediction of a catastrophic release or bubble of methane. But nobody knows when. It could happen now, it could happen in 10 years or decades. But you can see here that what the mechanism is that there are methane stores in the magma, in the lithosphere, which has been held in check by the frozen layer of the permafrost. But then since that's melting, it allows the bubbles to come up from the lithosphere. Such a release could have an exponentially amplifying effect on global warming, launching catastrophic scenarios more rapidly than we had anticipated. And here you see where we are with carbon dioxide right before 2020. Well, once methane starts getting released, it goes into a negative feedback loop that is actually logarithmically and higher, and could heat up the atmosphere to a point where, you know, we can't do anything about it. So the methane is something that nobody seems to know about, but it's happening. I have to say that I no longer believe that the work we do as individuals will be able to effectively contribute to averting this long-predicted crisis. Science has determined that even if we do go to zero carbon today, as I mentioned, the Earth would still continue to heat up. We are now in a state of emergency, but we don't know it. Most of us don't. The scientists do. We don't have another 50 years, or perhaps even 15 years, before the effects of global warming, such as devastation caused by more powerful and frequent weather events, desertification of the middle and west parts of the U.S., flooding of coastal areas and once safe lowlands, catastrophic storms, loss of agricultural land, and the loss of plant and animal species as those that migrate from the south are upon us. As landscape architects, our remit is to be the stewards of the landscape. But I sadly conclude that our professional ethos and our excellent professional practices are irrelevant in the face of global warming, a problem whose magnitude we are just now beginning to get, understand, and try to confront. I'm not advocating that we cease our professional jobs or carrying out our individual responsibilities of practitioners, but my message today is that we all must go beyond our professional remits in order to broach this critical environmental crossroad. And the question before us is, what can be done to keep this scenario from playing out? Paul Beckwith, who is a client scientist at the Department of Geography at the University of Ottawa, has a theory called his three-legged bar stool, which is a scenario to stabilize climate and ensure long-term human survival. Okay, well, that's me doing a PowerPoint. But the first one is to cool the Arctic as soon as possible. The second one is to remove carbon dioxide and greenhouse gases. And lastly, to bring our fossil fuel emissions to zero. Actually, in that order. And the reason for that is that the energy efficiency of bringing down our, you know, our actually kind of creating a renewable economy and bringing down our emissions can go a long way, but it's not enough to bring us back from the climate precipice, which is why the first two legs of the stool must be done in order to buy us time to change our behaviors and transition from an oil-based economy. But this transition is predicted to take from 30 to 50 to 100 years, because in order to bring up, the world is going to 10 billion by the end of the century. 20% of that are people like us who can kind of avoid it. But if you want social equity for the other 80%, it's just going to require more economic development, which will require more energy. So we're never going to really get behind this idea that we can change to renewables in time for us to really deal with the onslaught of global warming. In the face of these facts, well, I feel helpless. And the scale of problem just feels insurmountable by any one individual. But my message is this: we must continue to do what we do, but now we need to do more. We must collectivize and become activists. Of course, there are things that we can do within our respective practices that can make a difference in terms of trying to persuade our clients to build and plan sustainably. But now we must educate ourselves and advocate and talk to anybody who will listen. We must raise awareness that abrupt climate change is the largest threat that has ever faced humanity. We must also advocate for the larger scale actions, such as cooling down the Arctic and extracting greenhouse gases from the atmosphere in order to attack global warming at a geoscale. New geoscale technologies must be researched and developed as a national and international concerted effort so these new technologies can be safely deployed. But we need this to be top down and have governmental financial support, similar to that of the Manhattan Project, a weapons race with the Soviets to research and develop the first nuclear weapons during World War II. Also, we initiated the Apollo mission when the US was in a space race with the Soviet Union. In each case, these projects were deemed a threat to national security, which resulted in a direct nationally coordinated response to what was considered an immediate threat. But global warming is a direct threat to the United States as well as the rest of the world. But we in the US particularly have a responsibility and the resources to put together such programs, since we still have the biggest carbon footprint of any place in the world, as it would require actually a small percentage of our overall national budget to do so. This is not a technical problem, because there are all sorts of incredible technologies and people working on them out there now. But it is a problem of will, of political will. And we lack the will to recognize the issue, much less fund solutions to it. And now even more so because of Trump's election, as we heard. As individuals, students, and professionals, we must exert pressure on our politicians and power brokers to fund this. My call tonight is a call to action to you. We must advocate through supporting political grassroots movements to persuade power brokers and politicians to support this type of collectivized effort for geoscale technologies and solutions at any scale to change the course of this imminent threat in order to protect our collective futures. Lastly, as individuals, you must think of what you can do as an individual to support this cause in any way you can. It is important that everyone find one's own bully pulpit or way of making a positive contribution, because it's actually your futures and your children's futures which stand in the crosshairs of this. I'm old, you know, I'll croak before the shit really hits the fan, but you guys are going to be around, and so will your children. There are many groups that are now working hard to organize and educate people about what can be done, such as 350.org. But if you are interested in a list of organizations who are doing research on climate change communications and on basic technologies and just information about what's going on, you can see me after the presentation, and I can send a list that I've actually just collated on my own of different organizations that are doing things. And you can get on your computer and take a look at what's going on, because you need to do that. That's how you will educate yourself to really what's happening and dig in. Okay, so that just followed up. Yeah, Brad McKee's little ASLA message to us. All right, so on to, let's skip over reality, and now we can go to design, okay? I just thought I would put this out here. This is kind of as an introduction to our work. This is a little introduction to my brilliant career and my career planning. And basically, it starts basically around 1980, and it shows that I've picked up and moved my office in total 5 times. So you'll see that there are different destinations. The first one was in Boston, and the second New York, and then those little pink blobs, that's where when I had my babies on top of that. And then kind of circling back down from San Francisco to Cambridge, and then not really deciding to go to London, which is London, but that was kind of a non-decision. I ended up there with our little kind of Shanghai thing, and then kind of now back to New York. But all I'm saying here is that I don't do this at home. I don't recommend this. Hopefully you'll be better at career planning than I was. But I've been practicing landscape architecture for 39 years and have taught for 24. So, I mean, if you add that up, that's 63. And I don't know what that number means, although it is extremely high. As Shannon said, yeah, we do work not all over the world, but we work, we've always worked in different places around the world. Our work is site-specific. My background is in fine arts, and I always thought site specificity was very important because every site tells its own story, which naturally results in doing something different every time out, which is also something I don't recommend that you do if you want to make any money. I don't make a distinction between art and design, as I think that today that discussion is irrelevant. But my philosophy has always been that man-made landscapes can be a cultural art form, like painting, dance, writing, music, and architecture, and a means of connecting to people on a psycho-emotional level. We give them meaning and communicate through how we shape and form our landscape. And a landscape does not have to be a re-representation of naturalism. It can be anything you can imagine it to be. It can hold content and be visually and conceptually inventive. Our practice is an avowedly urban practice. It always has been, especially when cities were really out of fashion a while ago, not that long ago. We believe that the most sustainable form of human habitation is a city, and this is why we need to more sharply focus our activities on sustainability as it pertains to the urban landscape. The efficiency of proximity, characteristics of cities, leads to collectivization, allowing for ecological successes such as superior water stations, sewer treatment plants, as well as electricity consumption patterns. It allows for more efficiencies through public transport, which cuts down our carbon footprint and allows us to use precious resources in a much more efficient way. Of course, designing landscapes involves advocacy for the natural systems that need to be embedded or protected within the urban environment. I know, in spite of our reputation as being non-sustainable because we use color in the landscape, Sustainability does underlie every project we do, but it does not dictate the way it looks. What a place looks like must serve human beings and create a way for people to connect to a place. The specific design or art of the physical form of our landscapes will enable people to make an emotional connection to a place by imbuing it with character, memory, identity, orientation, and individuality. The emotional connection of people to place will often determine the longevity of a piece of built environment. Form and visual content can largely determine the success of regenerated and newly built urban environments. Our practice is often asked to create a there-there and establish an identity, often in places which have lost their context or identity. We are often tasked to decipher what that image should be, one that is unique to a particular place, reflects an authenticity of a place, and will be embraced by the public. As well, as we globalize and become more homogeneous, there is an increasing longing for people, communities, and now cities to be viewed as unique. Alongside of the seemingly fundamental human need to be seen as special, distinctiveness and uniqueness may give a city a competitive edge, something of crucial importance to new and regenerating cities. Even further and of greater importance is that the landscape and its quality or lack thereof forms the bedrock of our own self-image and self-esteem. In conclusion, it's the specifics of the design that will play a large factor in whether anything sustains over time. If a space is not designed to the spiritual, psychological, and emotional needs of people, it will have no appeal and therefore a limited shelf life. Design can create value and motivate us to invest and maintain our open spaces, perhaps the most vulnerable organ of our urban environments, which in turn will create longevity and cultural continuity. Design in itself cannot make cities successful, as cities are very complex layering of moving parts. However, for a city to function maximally, the design quality of a city's public realm components becomes extremely important. Design quality is a crucial factor in whether a city can reach its fullest potential. A city's public realm landscape needs to be designed to be more than merely functional, but as wonderful, inspired, attractive places to live and work for all socioeconomic levels. Okay, I'm going to start off by just showing kind of some images of artists who kind of I was, you know, looking at and worshiping when I was in art school. And these guys, the earthworks artists, you know, these were seminal pieces of work that we hadn't seen before, certainly not at the scale. They were kind of manipulated landscapes that made us see the landscape in a completely different way. They were non-commercial. You couldn't sell them. They reinterpreted the landscape so that you actually saw it again. So being in art school, I was just amazed. And this is where the idea that, well, geez, maybe I want to Bill Smithson, of course, about process, you know, Walter de Maria and his lightning field, and about the connection to nature and seeing it in a completely different way. Nancy Holt's sun tunnels and Michael Heiser's double negative. I mean, these were, they changed the roadmap for us, for landscape architects. But I have to say, I was really, at the beginning of my landscape architecture career, which was a default move, it was a somnambulant, sleepwalking as a profession. It was really, really boring. It was super corporate, super white male, super, you know, like really the same old thing, concerned with appropriateness and kind of craft and, you know, the idea of content and concept, forget about it, or pushing, but nothing. It was really boring. And I thought, well, you know, I would like to, I went into school thinking, well, I was going to actually build landscape art. And that also was a very kind of off move. Landscape architecture school, my first year, I asked my chairman, I was at University of Michigan, can I take some art courses while I'm here in landscape architecture? And the chairman said, well, what does landscape architecture and art have to do with one another? And I'm like, I have no idea, because I don't know anything about landscape architecture, because I come from a family of architects, and, you know, my father is an architect and taught at Penn. He says, well, any idiot can plant trees. So that was my introduction to landscape. So I said, I don't know anything about landscape, so I don't know what the relationship is between art and landscape architecture. So he said, no, you can't take any art courses. It has nothing to do with it. So, okay, all right. So anyway, I kind of, I'm showing you this one old project. Otherwise, I'm going to be showing you new projects that we've been doing in the last 10 years, because nobody in the United States knows what we're doing. But I was working for a landscape firm trying to, after the GSD, trying to learn how to be a real landscape architect. But I was so bored out of my mind. I decided I had to do something with my hands, because, you know, as an artist, we use our hands and we make things. So I would come back from work and I decided I was going to do this installation, because my then husband, Peter Walker, and I were living in Back Bay, and we couldn't agree on what to do with our front garden, which is, you know, about 20 feet by 20 feet. So it lay fallow for about 3 years. And the neighborhood was complaining, but he had to go on a two-week or business trip, so I took matters into my own hands. And I set out to do this kind of installation, but it was based on a rule that I could only spend $100, and I could only buy things that were on my block around Back Bay. And so when Pete came back, there was this garden. I had done the front yard. And I like bagels. There was a delicatessen, and I got 8 dozen bagels. I dried them out, shellacked them, there was an aquarium shop. I got some purple aquarium gravel. Then there was a garden shop, and I got these purple flowers. And then I invited a bunch of friends in for a garden party, which meant we were drunk by the time Pete got. We were just on the sidewalk. But one of my classmates, Alan Ward, who's at Sasaki, I mean, he's like a professional photographer. So he happened to bring his 4x5 camera and took pictures of this garden, which lasted not more than 3 days. But that didn't matter. I didn't really care. But I had a friend who said, oh, well, you know, you should really send, the pictures were so beautiful. But he said, well, you should send them into your, you know, professional magazine. I'm like, yeah, you got to be kidding. Really? And he said, yeah, send them in, see what happens. So I sent the images in, and the editor, whose name is Grady Clay, decided to put the thing on the front cover. Now, I have to say, I did not draw that front cover. I said, why did they draw all those bagels? It would have been better in black. But they did. They put it on the front cover, and Grady Clay asked me to write why I did this. And I wrote an article about why the bagel is the perfect landscape material, why it's appropriate. And number one, it's cheap. It's democratic. Anybody can put them in their garden. They did well in the shade. They don't need watering. They're biodegradable. So what else could you want from a landscape material? It's perfect. And what this is a Dada piece, right? It's Duchamp's toilet in the Whitney Museum. It's like, okay. There's a toilet in the museum. What's that doing here? Well, it's a piece of art. It's Dada. But of course, the landscape architects, they didn't know that. And it created a maelstrom of of letters, and people freaked out. And I mean, basically, you could landscape the entire Northern Hemisphere and get three letters in the next week in about it. But this went on and on. And it was like, oh, I'm ashamed to be associated with Harvard, or, you know, she's just pulling her pants down, or this one is good, she's in it for the money. It's like, all sorts of, like, oh, you know, I was like, you know, an enfant terrible. But on the other hand, the kind of the younger people, like, oh, this is great, you know, all of a sudden it kind of cracked open possibilities. It was funny, it was absurd, you know, it was nuts, but it let a little air into what was really a very sleepy kind of area of subset of architecture, you know, and people dropped their subscription because the magazine was supposed to prove to the architects that we were solid citizens, you know, and as good as they were. And it was like, okay, we're not, you know, we're something else. but really, it's because of Grady Clay that I'm up here tonight, because it was just random. I don't know what he was thinking, but he was a provocateur. He was a very, Brad McKee and I just last week, we talked about Grady Clay, about what an incredible person he was for the profession, because he just decided to shake things up a little bit, and I just happened to be there at that time. Anyway, that's the Bagel Garden. That's probably the best project I will ever have done. It's like being a child star. Okay, well, there's another installation called the Whitehead Institute, and this is in back of Cambridge. I continued against my advice, because it was unprofessional to kind of do things without fees. But I was like, well, artists never work with fees. But we were asked to do this little room for the Whitehead Institute, which is MIT. They were one of the very first firms that, David Baltimore was the director, that did genetic engineering. And this is a brand new building with an outdoor courtyard. You can see how beautiful that outdoor courtyard was. But they had an art collection, and I was asked to do a temporary installation for this outdoor space. And I was like, this is where I learned about landscape architecture. It's like, oh, well, we really, really love nature. We really love nature. We love gardens. But there's no structure that can hold up anything heavy. There's no water out there. We don't have a budget for it. Nobody's going to take care of it. But, you know, we really do love nature. So, I mean, the hypocrisy of our culture in terms of how much we love nature was like, oh my God, really? You love it that much? But there's no resources given to it at all. And the architect, the client, didn't think anything about putting more steel so that you could actually put a tree in there. You actually have to, trees are heavy. You need steel. It costs more. So it was like, okay. But no problem. I can do this. And what I decided to do here was to create a garden. It's called the Splice Garden. That was really a kind of a cautionary tale about genetic engineering. And so I spliced together a Japanese Zen garden onto kind of a French Baroque garden. And that's what this is called, the Splice Garden. And here you see one side is kind of have these kind of French kind of clipped hedges, which are rolled steel covered in astroturf, because, you know, if you don't have water, you really can't grow anything. I know this is rocket science to architects, but plants need sun, and they need water, and soil. That's all you have to know, and that soil basically will weigh the same as water. So you need to engineer it. Okay, that's all you need to know. But so nothing actually weighs anything up here, because it couldn't hold anything, so there's nothing living. The other side is the Zen garden. However, there are these kind of clipped hedges as rocks in it. So, there we go. They left it up there for quite a long time. So it's, you know, it was actually, I mean, the thing is that they wanted a garden. They weren't going to pay for it. They weren't going to care for it. All they really wanted was some green. So I just painted it all green, put everything in there that was green. It was just green. And that was fine. You know, that's really all they wanted was some green. All right. Now, I just want to say, before I get into kind of what we've been doing in the meantime, is that the work that you're going to see is a work of collaboration. I've had an amazing number of super talented people working with me. Anybody who comes into our practice, I expect is actually going to come up with ideas. They have to produce ideas. I love ideas. I'm an idea junkie. And the work isn't all about my ideas. Okay, if my idea is the best idea, we do it. But very often, it's not necessarily the best idea. And I want people to contribute, and they do. I don't care from what station, what their title is. We often start off our projects with a design charrette, take a day, let everybody work on it. We do a pin-up. We look at them. We have these little drafting dots, and you know, there's a vote, a debate, and then we kind of figure out which of these kind of sketches start to suggest an aesthetic strategy. You need an aesthetic strategy also, because you can solve the whole list of problems, but if you hand over your work and it solves a problem and the client looks at it and says, "No, sir, I don't like it," you're dead. You know, I mean, people have to be able to buy into what it looks like. It's important. So, and also, you know, it's really about learning about the project and learning about the client, using design as a tool to do that. So I just want to make sure that you understand that these are not just me doing all this stuff myself, that the people in the office really make major, major contributions. This is a project that we did. I kind of blocked out the first part of it. That was stupid. Okay, so we did a project in Yorkville in Toronto a long time ago, maybe 25 years ago, which was very successful. And we were asked to come back to do this little nose of land as a park. And when we took a look at really how this functioned, there was like no way that anybody was going to ever come to this nose of land, because it was, you know, it looks like this. You know, it's noisy, it's stinky, it's going to be dark, it's in shadow. So it was like, you know, forget about it. This is never going to be a park, but we could do this as a gateway into the neighborhood because it was designated as a gateway element. So this is something that we are moving forward with. So one of the characteristic ecotypes on the Canadian Shield are these incredibly beautiful hemlock forests. So we used this idea of these kind of floating forests above the fog as this kind of inspiration. And this is what we're proposing for the site. We call it a salad bowl, but it's a very big bowl, stainless steel bowl, carrying, you know, a piece of this hemlock forest up. You know, it's about 4 meters up, and about 25 meters across. And the idea is that because people are basically running around the site in cars, the reflectivity of it, it's going to be a little bit hard to tell what's going on. And you're going to see these trees kind of lifted up, but not quite understanding where the bottom is because of its reflectivity. So the idea is that, you know, it's this kind of this floating kind of stand of hemlocks just kind of sitting there. And you can't get up on it. It's this kind of idealized little piece of forest just standing there in the middle of the city. This is a project that we did a while ago outside of Philadelphia, New Jersey. It's about 500 acres of Jersey pine barrens, and the client had a clay quarry. It was a completely polluted clay quarry in the middle of it. Let's see, can I show this now? And he also wanted to kind of create an organic farm for doing different crops, as well as invite artists like Sol Hewitt in to do different installations. So it was kind of a farm come art conservancy plus kind of nature conservancy all rolled into one. But what we did is we didn't really want to disturb the land at all because of the soils, but what we created farm space by basically shaving back the forest to open up fields that could be planted. So, you know, what you're seeing is this kind of big field, and then there are going to be, you know, walkways that have been kind of cut into the forest and different kind of axes. So it's kind of a strange mixture of this kind of French Baroque garden come farmer's field. Now, in the middle of it is this clay quarry, and this has all been cleaned out. I mean, it was just filled with cars and battery acid and probably, you know, bodies and, you know, newspaper stands, and it was just gross. So we cleaned it out, but the problem in this particular area is that there's a lot of clay, which makes it very difficult for plants to grow. Like plants don't grow in super dense clay. So we were working with an ecologist. He was brilliant. And he said, well, why don't you take the wood chips, you know, just chip all those trees. And we got a cement truck out there, and we mixed the wood chips in with the clay to make like a batter. And we ended up spreading this batter around on the ground to see whether, you know, through aeration and kind of adding some organics, maybe it would work. And within 1 year, it did. It came up. It was a miracle that actually that did work. But the ecologist, he was great. So this is what it looks like now. And it's an amazing place to watch birds because it's in a flyover path. And it is you know, it really functions as a nature conservancy. And it's really regenerating a whole series of ecologies. But in the same time, you know, you can kind of, you know, you'll see these kind of funny gumdrop trees that are all over the place, which kind of almost overlays this kind of natural kind of environment, this ecology on top of the structure of a park. And that these gumdrops kind of appear almost everywhere throughout these disparate pieces of farm. And then these cuts through the trees. So yeah, anywhere there was a farmer's field, we just kind of planted it. We bought a nursery and then planted these trees. And there's one guy who goes around and clips them into these gumdrops. I appreciate. And then farmers, you know, then the crops actually become kind of part of the design. And then this is the clubhouse. Actually, it's where they keep all the machinery. So this is where all the drinking and the fun actually happens. Okay, so I mean, this is kind of how I ended up over in the UK. We won this competition called Exchange Square, which is in Manchester. And this was built right after the 1995 IRA bomb, which, yeah, talk about kind of recreating a site or kind of using its context. Sometimes there's not a lot of context. And the city was very smart. They created a master plan, which really they invested in creating, you know, public open spaces and plazas to encourage people to move back into the middle of the city, because Manchester people just moved out. There was nothing down there. So, I mean, this kind of shows, you know, to your left. Oh, Don't tell me I'm on a timer. God damn it. Anyway, so to the left, you can see, I mean, that's the urban landscape, right? It's not architecture. It's not landscape architecture. The roads, it's just leftover spaces. So the great vast majority of what our landscape just looks like this stuff, because it's basically unclaimed territory. Here is that same space. And the driver, we always try to find a narrative about a site and what makes a site special. And in Manchester, of course, the history is very rich because it was the nexus of the Industrial Revolution. This is where it happened. But it wouldn't have happened, it turned out, without the introduction of trains and the ability to distribute the goods. So trains were also, train parts were manufactured here as well. The other interesting thing is that the old part of the city, to your right, was built on a geological outcropping of this Yorkstone. And then there was actually a stream, which they called the Hanging Ditch. And the road that was there was called Hanging Ditch Road. You know, as the Brits have these crazy names. And then the newer part of the city was on a granite outcropping, which is about one story above this building, which is called the Corn Exchange. So there was a differential drop between these two halves by one story. So what we did is we decided to introduce these ramps that took you down from the shopping district down to the Corn Exchange and divided each one of these ramps with these big, wide kind of curbs or basically seats that people could sit on. So this kind of shows the upper level, which again kind of gloms onto the rest of the shopping district that was granite, and with these kind of train seats that were made from, you know, parts of trains that were still there, and kind of bank into these ramps and benches that take you down to the lower level. And part of the idea behind our work is to try to engage people, to get people to use these spaces, to invent new ways of people using space, and also, given our culture today, we want more freedoms. We want to be able to use space, use things, explore them in a way that where we want to do it. I mean, Claire Cooper Marcus was always on me because I wouldn't put benches that faced each other. Therefore, I didn't know how to design public spaces because people like to sit in front of each other and talk face to face. Well, you know, Claire, that's not true. I mean, I don't know. She was like, no, I've got to sit in front of each other. Anyway, okay, so you know, these could be beds. You could lie down on them. You could stand up on them. And this is great. If you want to lie down on these benches, you can take a pillow, take a nap. I mean, that's, you could sit back to back. You could just sit facing one way, another way. But this is what we need to be thinking about is how do people use space? What do they do? What do people do? And what kind of opportunities can you give them? Okay, so here's the Hanging Ditch, and we kind of resurrected this thing, and then we realized that, oh my God, we created this stream, but now we've divided the space again. So the next step was just to actually fill it back up with stone so that you could cross. And more people walk on this ditch than walk on the sidewalk. So, I mean, and it's a very interesting phenomenon, like why? Why do people do this? And the reason is that people actually like the challenge. You know, they see it, and they want to see what they can do with it. I mean, I have pictures of, you know, boys trying to ride their bikes on this thing. I mean, but, you know, when you dumb everything down, then you also make it boring for people. People really like to be challenged. And so, I mean, that's, you know, I think that's key to doing something interesting. And it's also key to be indemnified by the city also. But, you know, people are like, oh, you know, Martha Schwartz, she can't design spaces. It's, you know, it's always, you know, graphic pattern making. Well, this really became the central place to go hang out, get a sandwich at Marks and Spencer's, and then, okay, this wasn't great, but they put a television screen up on the Corn Exchange, and everybody watches the soap operas during lunchtime. So, I mean, it's just filled all the time. I mean, they went crazy. They actually wrecked it. I think they fixed it back up again, but they put a Ferris wheel in there, but it became like the central, you know, the living room for Manchester. Okay, this next one is in Dublin. It's called Grand Canal Square. And again, it's a kind of, it's a regeneration area. It was all kind of shipping. And here, I have to get on top of that timing thing. You can see that a great deal of the site in this image has not been built. And what the Redevelopment Authority did is they came to us and they said, you see that kind of red and white square there? They said, look, you know, we're just beginning to finish some stuff out. You guys need to design this plaza. It's on top of a garage. Of course, it can't hold any weight, like most structure in the city. But we need you to put something out there because, I mean, you know, temporary spaces, pop-ups, this is way before then. But the idea of creating these spaces before the event really happens is a way for a city or a developer or anybody who's building something showing that something is going to happen. So that's what they use it for. They said, you build this plaza before this. And Daniel Liebskind designed the Performing Arts Center that is in the parking lot right in back of it. They said, just build it now, because we need to really get people interested in the development of this area. And for God's sakes, do something that's colorful, because Dublin is really gray. So here it is. And there is, you know, everything's been built up now, and Google is there, and you know, I mean, it's a real central spot now in Dublin, and the big white roof is the Liebskind Performing Arts Building, and there is the plaza in front of it. Now, I mean, let's just talk about architecture for a second. I mean, most of my family are architects, you know. Father, sister, son, cousins, husband. I mean, it's a mess. It's like a congenital disease. But I mean, I never wanted to be an architect because I grew up in my father's office. That was, you know, the toilet templates and suites catalog was like, forget it. It's not going to happen. But I mean, I very, very much love architecture. And it's really, really important for us that what we do has a dialogue with the architecture. There has to be a conversation. It might be yin and yang, or in this case, it's the same thing. But there's got to be a relationship between the architecture. It's so important that, you know, the landscape and the architecture work together, because that way it makes everything a lot better. In this case, and it was funny because our client would not let us meet with Liebskind. He basically said, do whatever you need to do. But when we saw what Liebskind was doing, and the fact that it's a civic building, which gives it primacy in this space, it's more important than the other buildings because it belongs to the public. And also, given the, you know, the aggressiveness and the, and you know, the aesthetic of the building, we thought, well, hell's bells, we're just going to Liebskind the plaza. So it really meant that the building and the site really came together and really, you know, it didn't look like it was had landed from outer space. It looked like it belonged there. So when we showed it to Daniel, he was like, oh, I love this. And it's like, yeah, why wouldn't you, basically? It's but, and there's the building. So the building and the landscape, I think, are very at peace with one another. And I mean, I'm always interested. That's what our second to last book was about. It says, you know, we did a lot of research in terms of, well, what is the effect of these open spaces around the surroundings? I mean, how does it really affect the city? And I mean, this is such a destination point now. I mean, everybody knows about these kind of red sticks. They're lights, you'll see. And during the downturn, when Dublin almost went bankrupt, everything around the square kept its value. The restaurants were full, the hotels were full, the office spaces were full. It was a place where people wanted to be. So these places, these spaces really do create value and become a place, you know, for the public to really express themselves. So they really are very, very important spaces. And now that we're densifying and we're all moving back to cities, these open spaces become more and more valuable. Yeah, I mean, we like to do things where people, you know, get involved, they get wet, they get into it. And then the lighting, unfortunately, because it's a photograph, but this light, the light goes up and down these poles. You can put them on a timer, and, you know, it kind of creates a very much more dynamic space because of the lighting. This one we did fairly recently. It is the Place de la République in Paris. We work with TKV Architects in Paris. They were our kind of our joint team on this. We won it in a competition. This shows the Place de la République as it was, and you can see there's a statue of Marie, who symbolizes the Republic of France in the middle, and the rest of it is completely taken over by cars. Cars have primacy here. This is actually a real picture of what it is now. And I would say the biggest success was kind of at an urban design scale, where we were able to convince the traffic engineers to actually make the cars go around and then fill the rest of the space up so that we could attach the space back to the city. I mean, there is this ability for a service road, but service, and then connect it, you know, this way so that the people from inside this district could actually have a direct access to the square. It's also a big nexus for public transportation. We had to deal with an existing bosque of trees. Some were in good shape, some were not. And it was a very simple scheme. I mean, we really just really needed to kind of replant the bosque of trees, reconnect it to the city. Sometimes just doing super simple things is the thing to do, you know, given its context. It didn't need much. But of course, you always need an outdoor cafe so people can eat, kick back, get a cup of coffee. Steps are always wonderful places for people to meet and greet. And then the real contribution was to create a plaza for protests. I mean, to the French, this is super important. And when you take a look at protests in Paris, it's in this square. You really take a look at it, that's where it's happening. So this was impossible before. So I feel very proud that this was now being able to be used by the people of the city as opposed to the cars, and doing all sorts of things. I love skateboarders. My sons were skateboarders. I'm all for it. Okay, now we're going to go to China. China, we have been doing quite a bit of work in China. Avanca is the largest developer of housing over there. And you may all be aware that Stephen Hall did this kind of massive skyscraper set on its side, the building. And he also actually designed the landscape for it as well. So when we started working in China, they got in touch with us because the landscape itself was failing. And, you know, I have to say, you know, if you're an architect, it's a good idea to actually work with a landscape architect just in general. But the problem was is that these slopes had to be re-engineered because it turns out that, you know, soil doesn't like stand like that by itself. It just doesn't. It's called the angle of repose. And also underneath the buildings, you need sun in order to grow things. A natural landscape may not actually end up looking like what you think, you know, Vermont looks like, you know. So they were not really happy. They wanted to know whether we could actually come in and try to fix it up. So we did. I mean, with respect to Stephen's plan and his ideas for these kind of very mounded shapes, we went with that. We had to add things and change things, but our planting scheme, because they were very lumpy and bumpy and not beautifully actually graded, we used plants that were much rougher textured.
And then we replanted them with a plant palette. And in this way, you could really perceive the mounds much more distinctly than before. So Vanke really, they liked it. We're still working with them now. Been a good client. This one we did. This was a horticultural festival in Xi'an. And let me go back here. This was a space that was, you know, there were, I don't know, six master gardeners. If you're a master, that really means something in China. So that was, I didn't know that, but that was, you know, that means that you are it. That's great. So they pay attention to that. I mean, that felt good. But I mean, these spaces are very small. They're about 30 meters by 30 meters. So there were six of us there. But knowing we were going to have to build in a place where we didn't have a lot of control and somebody else was going to build it, the first big idea was like, why don't we build it out of materials that they know how to use, as opposed to reinventing the wheel, number one, so the craftsman can just kind of build it and it'll look okay. And so, and then also, you know, taking cues for the language there. And in Xi'an, this is the place, you know, where the terracotta armies were, and the land is Los, which is where all these kind of, the houses were carved out of these Los fields, and the use of arches is very prevalent. And then, of course, in the temples are these beautiful arches, and then they have this gorgeous, beautifully proportioned gray brick. And then the use of willows and then lighting them green also is very popular there. Now, they gave us a topic, which was the harmonious relationship between city and nature. And of course, we're not going to be given a topic. That's like crazy. So, you know, we thought we weren't going to do that. Well, we weren't going to do that. So, I mean, this is an initial sketch that I did before we started. And I thought, well, I've always had this this kind of love affair with the walled city of Kowloon. They tore it down before I could ever get there. Probably it was that was good. But this sketch really shows almost a garden maze where, you know, it's just made out of walls with openings, and that the bottom of it was, you know, brick, and the roof was willow. So that was kind of an initial sketch for this idea. And here is actually a plan for our garden, and those gray lines are these walls, and through which there are these kind of these openings, these doorways. They lead you into hallways, none of which really are parallel. So you're walking through these spaces, your eye is not going to tell you they're not parallel, but it's not going to feel quite right either. You know, you won't really know what's not right, because our mind will try to normalize the walls. And you'll see at the end of each hallway, well, you'll see. Now, as it turns out, we did do the harmonious relationship between city and nature. Nature being the roof, the bottom of it is the city. So here is a CGI of one of these hallways. At the end of each of both ends of the hallway is a mirror. So then it gives the impression that the city is going on forever. And this is when it was just installed. So it's very kind of surreal. Now, here we are at the beginning, the opening of the exhibition. And I thought, okay, this is working. Because when we first got there, there was a line of trash cans up against the wall. It was like, you know, I guess we succeeded in making it feel like it was city, because somehow they all felt okay about putting the trash up against this brick wall. But then we had to convince us, no, this is a garden. You have to take the trash cans away. But you walk in, and the first thing that you see is, again, it's completely mirrored. And then we started watching people, and it turns out that the most interesting thing for people are themselves. And then there are all these choices of which door to enter, and in the Chinese culture, that's not comfortable. You know, it's like there are no signs. You don't know where you're going. You don't know where you're going to get to. So there's this whole kind of feeling of angst about it, which was intentional. And then these kind of mirrored ends. But when people started coming in, it was very interesting because people started doing very odd things, following each other. There was incessant photographing of oneself. This one hallway ended up kind of being too narrow to get through. And then I was followed by this guy, this photographer, so then I started following him and photographing him. And then if you did not walk through, actually it was pretty simple, if you just didn't go through the middle aisle, you'd end up going straight to the end. But if you didn't do that, you would end up in a room that was mirrored, and then you'd have to go back out again. And also the trees had like 1,000 bells, which is also traditional in Chinese gardens. But again, it was, it was kind of annoying with all these bells ringing all the time. But so then you had to walk back out. Now, finally, when you get through to the end, you come to this room, which when you look through the glass, you see this kind of endless forest of willows. So you go from this endless city into this kind of endless forest. And that's kind of what this looks like, because of the reflection. You can kind of see this mirrored space and back with the mirroring. It's all about this kind of reflection. So then at the end, then you get to walk out. You think that's it? But no, turns out that these mirrors are all one-way mirrors, and you have been watched the entire time. And the hallways were full. It was a party. It was like completely voyeuristic. And there would be people who were really upset that they had been watched, and then they would stand and watch other people. I mean, this poor woman didn't know. She's adjusting her underwear. All sorts of things. This girl was really funny. She kicked her boyfriend out of the room. She didn't want him in the room. And she photographed herself. So, I mean, if I were his mother, I'd say. I like this one. I mean, this guy looks so in love, right? I mean, it's great. I mean, it was quite a party. This next one, again, this is with Vancouver, and it was part of a vast mixed-use development in Chongqing. And Chongqing is a very hilly city. It's a small city of 30 million, if you haven't heard of that. And in Chinese development, the sales center is all important, because what you want to do is you want to be able to sell all your units before you build them, right? So you have to have a really good sales center. So our design takes place in this kind of funny red shape there. And again, there is a narrative to this and problems, which is that it's on a hillside. There's a highway there. You have to get the cars off the highway, down the side of a hillside, all the way down to the sales center, which is like all the way at the bottom. So it was like, well, how are you going to get people off the road down the hillside? It's like Mission Impossible. So, and by the way, the zigzag is, where you take the golf cart down the side of the hill to get to the sales center. So we did a Hansel and Gretel scheme, where we drop pieces of breadcrumbs, and it's called Fengming Mountain. And we made these kind of these sculptural mountains as a way of guiding people down the hillside so that they could actually get to the sales center. And that's what these things look like. I mean, the other piece of it in terms of design is that because there was such devastation and, you know, it just looked like the end of the world on the site, we were instructed to make sure that people's vision was actually kept within this area. So, you know, we made walls that were astroturfed and made sure that you couldn't really see what was happening outside this one space. Now, you'll see to your right, there is a raised terrace, and that this raised terrace, this is the wall on the inside, it's a seat. But the reason for the terrace was so that you could get up and look down onto the units that were for sale. Just take a look at them, but not quite get to them. So it was this kind of raised parterre looking over, overlooking the sales units. So this one, I mean, yeah, this project was, okay, sorry, I'll take you. Okay, this one here is a project that's underway right now. It's a waterfront in Guangzhou, and it's pretty exciting because it's a, it is an industrial site, where they, a shipping site, where they basically would import all sorts of steel. So steel rods, rebars, rolls. And part of this effort was to really try to use a lot of what was on the site. And basically that upper portion is a master plan by Foster. The sales center is kind of that green space in the middle there, and the building is the kind of triangular building is the sales center, and then there's a bridge that crosses over to this park, which you can see this red gantry, which is existing there now. So we were in charge of kind of doing both sides and making sure that the sales center and the bridge over and the park basically connected to one another. So this is a sales center. You know, we used Core 10. We used a lot of industrial paving, really simple stuff, a lot of stuff that we stripped off the site, stockpiled, we're going to use again. And then this bridge takes you over to the other side, which is the park. And in order to kind of come down ramp-wise, we kind of had to come down, you know, snake people around, but lifted up pieces of the landscape, and then we had program and restaurants kind of underneath these kind of big piece slabs of earth. Now, there was a ton of refuse left behind, so throughout the park we kind of used these rebars and leftover pieces as kind of sculptural items. This other side, this is again where the housing is. Sorry. Oh, what happened here? Ugh. Does this work with the, oops, yeah. Sorry. Let's try this again. What? Oh, it's here?
Yeah.
Okay. What was that? Okay. So this other side is, it shows the gantry. And what we did on this side is that this gantry still moves up and down tracks, but we jackhammered up the concrete so that it would form these kind of big blocks of kind of cracked concrete, and then lifted out stones that were big enough or pieces of it that could be lifted out and created places where we could plant trees. So we kind of left a lot of the concrete in place, ground up other concrete so we could create kind of a ground cover. And the middle of this thing is a nursery so that we can use the trees to plant inside the development. So it's kind of a working industrial landscape. And here you can see that there is this where the gantries move up and down the tracks, we made this hallway, double-sided hallway, out of this rebar. And this rebar is going to actually create these kind of super long trellises that will be planted with wisteria. And you can walk in between these two walls. So, I mean, this will be a very kind of beautiful place eventually to walk within. And this kind of shows a section. And you can see, you know, the nursery in the middle. And then it's tough to see the tracks where the rebars are, but then kind of these big plantation of trees along the edge. The other part of the island is a playground and a cafe. And we've designed this playground. And then kind of a box park cafe. This is the last one, folks. This one has just been completed. It's in Beijing, and it's a huge mixed-use development. And this is a site under construction. The plan here shows the top part is those three buildings have a retail on the bottom, an office on the top. And I wanted to make sure that these things were all connected on this big plinth. And then to the right and the bottom are housing. And then to the lower left is another office tower. And the middle of it is the Central Park that actually steps down to a convention center underneath. And the top part is kind of an ecological garden to clean the water. So, I mean, it's a massive mixed-use project. This kind of shows a kind of a model through the Central Park as it steps down. And that kind of round building is a sports center. And then this is an illustration of kind of what we wanted. We wanted to create this like sea of seating that would be both sculptural but also invite people to kind of sit in there and or lie down or do whatever they want. So this is the project, and this is kind of looking down the Central Park, the Sports Center. To your left is housing, and the yellow is a children's playground. And to the right, you see, is kind of the retail and office, and then that kind of plinth. This is this area here. So what I was looking for here was I wanted to shred this plinth's edge so that it started to kind of creep out into the landscape in order to entice people to come out. And we lifted up the plinth 18 inches, so the edge of the plinth itself was a seating element. So as many landscapes work when people can sit down and relax and, you know, kick back. If you don't have places to sit, you don't have a successful space. So here, these are these kind of pieces, like pieces of a thread being pulled off. And the sides are kind of perforated metal and the tops are wood. And then at nighttime they glow. Okay, here we're stepping down from the Central Park to the lower part. And we're kind of stepping around the sports building. And as we're stepping down, they're kind of like this wall of drawers that are opening up and spilling water or being planted. And again, you know, inviting people in, kids, you know, to play, that's great. They're probably not supposed to go in there, but that's fine. You want to encourage them to kind of break the rules and play. So this is the lower part of the Central Park. Okay, this is the playground at the bottom of the resi, and of course, playgrounds are very important in the culture there. And it also happens to be, you know, if you take a look, it's also where you go down to the garage. So you have a playground at the same place where you're going down to the entrance of the garage, but no problem. So there we go. And what we did is that in order to kind of separate the resi from the commercial and office is that, you know, we had kind of a strip of of planting that kind of created a horizontal barrier, a walkway, another horizontal barrier, which was a water feature, which also helped to clean and run the water. And then you're into the resi territory. So a series of kind of subliminal walls that kind of created a spatial differentiation between uses. So this is a part of the playground. Kind of industrial scale sliding boards. And this is a giant rat wheel. I mean, whole families can go in there and kind of walk around, and the whole thing is on ball bearings. And then here's this water feature, the stream. And people are definitely in it. This is a narrow end. These are the office towers, and it's interesting because very few people actually are going to be in this plaza, so we wanted to do something that kind of was, graphically interesting. The bamboo will actually become much bigger in here, but we also have kind of sculptural pieces in here that kind of create almost this kind of strange 3D confusion. Okay, so the culture is very appreciative about creating gateways into any kinds of projects. A gateway moment, I think, is very, very a proper entry is a gateway. So here we have a gateway that is at this part of the site where this kind of eco garden is. It's kind of for allowing the water to percolate into the ground and also to help to clean it. And then here is this gateway, and it's it's perforated steel. It has this green glass roof to it because it is part of the garden after all. It's green. And the inside of it is painted green. So that at nighttime it kind of glows green, has a kind of different aspect to it. And then the last piece of this is this other gateway. And this is a very weird gateway. It's kind of this insect-like creature thing that is kind of walking down this corridor. So, people like it because it has this kind of, this animalian quality to it. Yeah, it's like a bug. And there we go. That's it. Thank you all very much for your patience. Thank you.
So we have time for a few questions. If there are any questions from the audience,
it's all very clear, huh? Yes. Absolutely. Yes. Just time to come home. My family's here. Yes.
How do you negotiate your ideas with your clients in terms of budgets and what they want?
That's a very good question. Very good question. Well, first of all, the first step is to offer your client a couple ideas so that you can really find out what they want. Because people are super inarticulate when it comes to the landscape. Oh, we want, something nice, some water, something, So it's better to really offer them a few different strategies, ideas, so that they can tell you what it is that they want and what they like. And if you do that and start going down a track that they've helped to shape, then they're more likely to be more invested in it and more enthusiastic about getting it done. Okay, so that's one thing. The other thing is that when we do a concept for somebody, we're not thinking about budget. We're thinking about what's needed, kind of how to kind of make something that will probably exceed what the client is even expecting. I mean, let's face it, nobody needs a landscape. You don't need a landscape. You need something to live in. Nobody needs a landscape. You don't need a painting. You don't need music. You don't need a novel. You don't need it to survive. So it's kind of, well, it's one of these things that you try to create a desire in somebody, you know, a desire for something that they could not have imagined. That's why we're here, is to try to imagine something that they couldn't imagine. And what often happens is, I mean, often, I'm not even given a budget. I don't know what the budget is. But, or, you know, at some point we're told what the budget is, but very often what happens is that if they see something that they really want, people are very, very creative at getting things they want. You really need that pair of shoes? Gotta have them, right? So you decide not to buy something else because you need your shoes. So it really becomes it's not as though we don't participate in figuring out where the important things are to keep and change other things, but we're in command of those decisions. In order to get what the client wants and what we think is best, we meet budgets. We're like everybody else, but if you can actually figure out how to kind of commandeer your resources, like we don't really need that fancy paving, let's just put gravel, fine, but keep this. But very often, if the client sees something that they really, really want and they think is going to bring them value, you know, they can see it, they'll pay for it. Just like everybody else, you know, like you see something you want, that car, that this, that that, you know, you figure out how to make it work. You make trade-offs. So, you know, our job is to really show them something that they really like. I mean, it's not that easy, but, you know, there are always tears before bedtime, but, you know, people are often willing to pay for something that they really, really think is good for them, that they'll cherish. Any other questions? Yes?
Given your preamble about global warming, do you think we should be trying to make lower carbon impact landscapes, or do you think we should trade that a little bit? You use carbon to create the best cultural landscapes we can, with the assumption that that has a maybe greater function in terms of making cities more habitable.
I don't know. It'd be very nice to have that debate. It doesn't matter. I'm sorry to say that. We should do what we think are the best trade-offs, but this isn't going to stop that train. I mean, what are there, 20,000 landscape architects? I mean, it's... But that doesn't mean that you don't do the right thing. Maybe you could figure out how to stuff your next project full of trees so you can sequester more carbon dioxide. You know, I mean, you know, it's... I don't have an answer to that. I just don't know. I don't know, because you're right, you know, by consolidating people and making, I've been working with Harvard Forest. I'm trying to figure out what to do for my next studio, and one of the biggest problems in terms of really combating more putting more greenhouse gases out there is the lack of land use. And they've done these scenarios. If we just keep on kind of allowing ourselves to spread and be inefficient, that's the worst thing that we can do, because number one, we won't have enough room to plant forests that do help to sequester greenhouse gases. And guess what? We're all going to have to be self-sufficient in terms of providing food for ourselves. So you don't have enough places to plant so you can grow your veggies. So land use planning is absolutely critical to making us efficient. You don't get me started on this, but okay. Yeah, so I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of trade-offs, yeah. That wasn't fun, but.
thanks a lot.
Okay, very, very welcome. Thank you all, thank you.